I'm Mr. Jackson, and this is Devin and Sanaya. And today, we're going to discuss what we just watched, what we just witnessed. All right, so I'm going to ask a question. And the audience, feel free to, if you have any questions or any comments, feel free to raise your hand, and we'll make sure that you are heard. All right? So first question I want to ask, what were your raw feelings watching that piece that we just watched on Black Wall Street?
It was sad, and it was uncalled for, especially thinking about, like, how that would have went down this present day.
Devin?
Well, I think, like, it was sad. It wasn't needed. It was like they overpowered them, and they didn't really have nothing to fight back with. They could, like, run.
Was that your first time hearing of that story?
Yeah.
Wow. Why do you think that's so? Like a piece of history of that magnitude. Why do you think that's not talked about more in schools or just in general?
I feel like talk about that at school would probably, like, I don't know. It wouldn't really seem fit for a teacher's curriculum.
Yeah,
especially at the age we started learning about Black history, I don't think that's the first thing they'd teach us.
And they're not going to make it known to, like, the world, because they don't want everybody else thinking that's what the United States is about.
And they don't want to create more hate towards whites right now.
Okay. So let me ask you for a second, so we can all get in the mindset of what we just witnessed. All right, just imagine like we at school today, right? And all of a sudden, all of our phones start going off and we get an alert, right? And the alert says that in Kankakee, like downtown Kankakee, all the way from the east, all the way to the west of Court Street was all destroyed, right? Or that it was like helicopters, planes from the sky were coming down and shooting businesses up, and bombs went off, or people were just being massacred inside the buildings. Right now, live time, how would you feel?
I'll feel bad, because with it, like, being Kankakee in a small town, we already don't have much. So the little stuff that we do have, it's like, it's not much, but it's much to us because we're a small community and we're tight and we're close. So I feel like that will set us back a lot, and
I don't think we can really do much about it. If they do come try to do something, we all are going to have to run, for real, unless you got stuff to fight back with.
How do you think the mentality of the individuals then? Because when we think of stories like that, we hear the story that happened, that we think of the adults, but there were kids. If you watch the video, there were kids that were harmed, that were murdered, right? And also, the survivors, they were kids. So they remember seeing this trauma, but there also were kids that were brought down to partake in the unnecessary and senseless massacre of that community on Greenwood. So what's your thoughts? What are your thoughts? Explain to me your thoughts about kids being involved on both sides of the spectrum.
I feel like when it comes to, like, the fighting part, kids should never have been brought into that. But when it comes to, like, the running stuff, there's nothing they can do. Like, that's like somebody breaking into your house and you at home sleep. You can't do nothing about that. Like, anybody could be put in that situation. But for kids, like, on the running side, I feel like that would trigger their fight or flight, especially out here.
It ain't really nothing. Like, I don't know how they was back then. That was like 100 years ago plus that. And the kids back then might be, their parents was probably like that. Like now, I don't think kids that are like 10, 12 would probably go do that now. So I don't know. It was probably just back then.
And I have some numbers, all right? Let's briefly discuss these numbers. An estimated 35 blocks burned to the ground. As many as 300 dead, but on record saying that it could have been over 1,000. Hundreds injured, 8,000 to 10,000 left homeless, more than 1,400 homes burned or looted, and eventually 6,000 detained, right, in camps during this massacre. What message can we take from this event that can help us today, like nowadays, and not just And I want to talk specifically to teenagers, all right? Because adults always, you know, we tend to discuss subject matters as such as this, but I want to hear from a teenager perspective. Like, when you hear those numbers, how do you feel, and how can we take that information and how can we apply it to today to help us?
We just got to stop being against each other. Like, we all got to come together and, like, do stuff for our community, keep our community up, and just help us in the long run and to help our kids, because at the end of the day, we are the future of Kankakee or wherever else. So if we start now, then by the time we're 25 or 30 plus, things would be different. And when nobody think to try to come do this or that to Kankakee, because they already know how the community coming.
Yeah, I agree with that, because back then, they were really, white and blacks really wasn't getting together. And just like 5 years ago, they wasn't getting together. Like, everybody just need to come together. We all in one country. I don't think we need to fight or nothing like that. So if we just fix that and become one, we'll be fine.
From a teenager's perspective, what are some situations now? Well, we don't have a Black Wall Street situation, but what are some situations or social issues now that plagued the community, the Kankakee community, from you all's perspective? Let's speak louder.
I feel like it's really just the community scene is just the Black people coming together, but we don't, like, the Mexicans and the whites, we're not really mixed in. Like, you'll see a few Mexicans here and there with the Black people, but it's like we're still against each other. We don't do events with each other. And, like, we're seen as outsiders in our own community. So, like, even in school, if you take certain classes, you're seen as an outsider. Like, you don't feel like you're in the right place or playing certain sports as your certain race. Just stuff like that.
I don't really think, like, it's not too bad here, but it's probably some places that it is. Like, it ain't nothing to do here anyway. We really just got to go to school, and then after that you go home and do whatever you do. It ain't nothing, like, no sports or nothing to do here. So I think, like, it's not bad here. I don't know no spots that are still bad. The only thing I could think of that was bad is probably when they was rioting back in, like, 2020. Mm-hmm. That's really the only bad thing.
Oh, you mean, when you speak of bad, you're speaking in context of, like a race, like race matters. But let's kind of extend that conversation, though. What other issues do you believe that's plaguing the community?
Gun violence against each other. Yeah. That's the biggest thing in our community right now that we need to work on.
Like, they need to make it harder to get guns. Like, because kids our age be having guns, and they just buy it from a random person.
Drugs is another problem. And that usually starts from, like, an adult pushing that kid towards that lifestyle.
Yeah, like, the parents, they're not teaching us. Like, some parents will just let them do whatever they want, and you are what you be around. Is what they say, and their parents let them be around them when they kids, so they're going to do it when they get older.
So, Devin, you mentioned that there is not much to do, and that's a narrative that you hear about Kankakee. And I'm going to ask the audience if anyone wants to chime in on this, but by a show of hands, who believes that there should be more things for teenagers to do in the city of Kankakee? Who believes that to be true? All right. If you don't mind, if anyone doesn't mind, we can have a mic come down to you. You two will start off answering this question. What are, because a lot of times we discuss what the issues are or what we want or what the issues are, but we don't always put that same energy into the solution. So what are some things or some resources that need to be brought to Kankakee, and briefly explain why?
I feel like we could just get a sky zone or something, we'll be fine. But, like, it's just a lot of gun violence out here, so I don't think if we get that, it probably won't be safe. A lot of people just going to be there trying to shoot. Like, we can't really have nothing to do. They don't know how to control themselves.
Yeah, our community doesn't really trust us, so they don't like to give us nice things or say we don't deserve nice things. But something, like, that they could put out here is, like, the old Golden Corral. They turned it to a Starbucks. That could have been, like, a roller skating rink or something. It's a nice-sized building. Is right in Bradley. It's not like in the middle of Kankakee or anything, in the middle of all the violence, as they say. But they don't really think about us much because they just see us as problems.
I mean, there was, like, things about there was supposed to be, like, a Great Wolf Lodge or something like that built around here, and there's supposed to be a like a sports complex in Bourbonnais, so that's something to do.
If anyone in the audience want to answer, what are some things, what are some resources that you would like to see brought to Kankakee, Kankakee City and the county, but also, but more specifically, Kankakee the city? You got one? What's something you'd like to see? No one? All right. So let me ask you this then. So do you think that if we had more, let's say we had a skating rink, that's what I heard, a skating rink, if we had more resources, do you think that that would do a lot for teenagers in terms of helping with their mental health, helping them be involved in the community, maybe curbing some of the violence that happens in the streets?
Yeah, because that gives them a chance to, like, get out the house and use their negative energy towards something positive. Like, everybody likes to be around their friends, be around other people's friends. Like, that's one thing we are good at. We good at, like, when it's time to party or do this, do that, we could do that together. It's not that bad out here. But if we don't get the opportunity, it's never going to happen. And then it's going to – the future generations, like the 4th, 5th, 6th graders – they see what their older siblings doing and what their parents doing. So by the time they get to junior high school, they just like them, if not worse.
I think a rolling rink would help the city because there ain't nothing like to do. So everybody just go home and sit in their room, and then every once in a while we have a little function going. But I feel like if they could do something like every Friday, I feel like nothing would be really bad around here. I feel like it would be more kids outside and having fun than inside not doing nothing and just thinking.
And it's a safer, like, kind of project, I'd say. Because, like, yeah, we throw our own parties, but, like, block parties and stuff, that's not the safest route to go at all. And then it makes the police look at us a certain way. And I feel like a roller skating rink or something along the lines of that would help prevent everything.
So the events that happened on June 1st of 1921, right, again, with – we believe thousands of people, up to between 300 to thousands of people, either murdered or injured in a horrific event. Peer pressure was something that was huge during that time as well, right? Think about it. There are probably a lot of people, especially going to the context of kids, right, or teenagers, who probably felt the pressure like, well, if my friends are doing this or my family doing it or my neighbor are going down participating in this, then I'm going to participate in it as well. So let's take that subject of peer pressure. How does peer pressure impact the lives of teenagers today?
I mean, that just goes along with, like, 9 times out of 10, you could pull any teenager out the school. It's a large chance that they either drink or smoke occasionally or frequently. So I feel like that goes along with peer pressure, because if you're around your friends and they'd be like, just do it, you being scary, this, not this, not. A lot of kids, like, they think, like, dang, if I don't do it, then they're going to be mad at me or they're not going to be my friend. So that's how a lot of stuff starts. And then once they start, they don't stop and it becomes a habit.
Yeah, I think that too, especially – like, they just don't want to be known as, like, damn, you ain't drink or something like that. Like, they just didn't want to be known. A lot of kids don't want to be known as that. Nobody can really fend for themselves. And it's a lot with gun violence, too, because you grow up, like you say, you browned your cousin and they do it or something like that. They going to want you to do it, too. And you don't ever do nothing by yourself. You always let them peer pressure you.
But what can we do what can adults do to help teenagers become more of a leaders and not follow negative trends and not give in to peer pressure? Because there's peer pressure not just with, like, the issues we're speaking of violence, but there are other things, or drug abuse or substance abuse, but there are other things that can affect the mental health of teenagers, right? And peer pressure will assist them in maybe engaging in activities or in a mindset that can be harmful to them or not allow them to be a leader, right? So what can adults do? We want to hear from you all. What can we do to assist you all now?
Like adults as in your parents?
But parents, teachers, coaches, mentors, other family members.
I think parents just keep your kids away from it. Like, even the parents be doing it, and they be doing it around their kids, so they be like, oh, I want to try that. And then, like, other people, it's really nothing they can really do. They don't have no say-so in the kid's life or not. It's really just up to the parents to raise them right.
You believe that? Like, you really? So, like, is there a coach or a teacher or any member in the community that has impacted your life that you view as a positive role model?
My parents raised me right. Like, they didn't do nothing around me. Like, they never smoked or drank around me when I was younger, so I never really, like, dang, I want to try that. But now it's like all the kids do it. I was like, there's no point to do it. Like, my parents raised me right. No other adult really had a say-so in my life.
I feel like it really starts at home. Parents need to start actually being parents and not being friends, or they need to actually be involved in their kids' lives, because a lot of parents, they don't know what's actually going on. So even when they do find out, it might be too late because they were too busy doing other things or worried about other things. And then personally, I have had a few coaches and, like, teachers and stuff that have impacted my life for the better. Like, they giving opportunities and, like, mentorship and, like, pushing me to do things that's out of my comfort zone, just stuff like that. But my mom, like, I'm used to having a mom that's really involved. Like, I've always been in sports, academic things. So when I see other kids and, like, they'd be like, oh, their parents, like, they don't really be there for them, or they always on their back and stuff. That's just something I noticed.
So you said a key word, and I'm going to ask the audience, by show of hands, the word mentor, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the definition of a mentor is an experienced and trusted advisor. So I'm going to go again with that definition. An experienced and trusted advisor. How many of you all right now believe that you have a mentor, you know, outside of your parents? Because some people may look at their parents as a mentor type form, but outside of your parents, how many of you all have a mentor in your life? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? And we have about maybe 35 to 40 teenagers here, right? So 5. What can we do to increase that number?
More teachers and people, like, in the community need to, like, okay, let's start with teachers. Some teachers are only here for the check. They're here to do what they were told to do, and then that's just that. But we like the teachers that go above and beyond and, like, show us that you're there for us. Don't just say that you're there for us, but actually do things to show and, like, just interact with us in general. And then with community members, since it's Kankakee, it's easy for community members to put together events, just stuff like that, like showing kids that you really care and that you'll do this or that for us. That goes a long way.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of adults, they could like start something. Like, yeah, we don't really need like parties or nothing like that. Like, we could just need something to do, and they won't really do nothing. And then, like, some adults, like, they be around and they be the ones selling them whatever they want. So, like, they just need to stop that and just have a, like, because they're just going to grow up and be like them. They need to, like, change. They don't want Kankakee to be good. They need to change it. They need to stop just, like, putting adults into everything and the kids and growing them into it.
So the power of a mentor is the fact that you have someone that will help you, like, walk through life. Like, someone that you – the key word, the definition was trust. All right, so someone that you can learn to trust, build the trust with, another adult that's outside of your parents that can assist you to go down the right path. But the key part is it kind of like a life-on-life mentality where they'll share their life with you, right, in a safe, appropriate manner where they will use advice or their experiences to assist you, to help you, right? How many of you all believe that teenagers need mentors? Just by a show of hands. If you believe that mentors are needed, by a show of hands, all right? So what could you do to vocalize the need for mentors to be in the lives of teenagers?
I think the biggest start would be social media. That's the easiest way to reach people nowadays. But yeah, just, or even, like, if adults take the opportunity to start them into a group themselves. Like, actually think about the kids in the community. Like, your kids are in the community, so you should want to do something. Or it can start with teachers, because We hear, 8 hours a day, not counting when we're after school and extracurricular activities. We would teach us more than we would our parents, if we're being realistic. So teachers should want to go the extra mile for the students just to make their job easier.
I feel like a teacher or anybody could really just, take, one period to just talk about it. Or, our CBE or something like that, we could just talk about it. And it might affect a few kids, but a lot of kids are already too deep in. They don't got no mentor or no anyone to trust to not do anything. So they're already too deep in, and that's just how they're going to live their life.
Mm. So social media, good segue, right? By show of hands again, how many of you all believe that social media has more of a negative impact on the mental health of teenagers than a positive impact? By show of hands. Wow, that's quite a bit. All right. According to one report, right, according to the American, according to research of American teenagers, teenagers who use social media over 3 hours each day face twice the risk of having negative mental health outcomes, including depression and anxiety symptoms. Why do you think that's so?
I mean, it's not always the most positive things projected on social media, and then a lot of that could come with, self-esteem, seeing people have stuff that you don't have, or being like, they so pretty, why don't I look like them? You know, stuff like that. But, and then it could come, we from a small community, so when we see kids that's from, big cities and the opportunities they get and the stuff that they do with their school, we dang, we ain't never had that, or we won't ever have that. Small stuff like that.
It's a lot of jealousy on social media and stuff, because somebody got something better than you and you get mad at them, and then you just put yourself down, put your parents down because they ain't do nothing right. It's just a lot of jealousy, especially with sports. Somebody will get an offer and it'll just be haters. It's nobody backing nobody nowadays. Everybody just hating on everybody.
Yeah, and then that's the most, that's the largest way. Our school is a lot of fights and everything else. It all starts on social media. It'll never start a person. It all starts on social media, and that's where it continues. That's where it boils over. Then in school, that's where it just gets out of hand.
So how can social media be used to change their narrative? Or being realistic, it will never really change 100%. But what can teenagers do, and what can adults do to help at least change some of the negative impacts that social media has on teenagers?
I don't think you can really change the negative impacts. It's more of it's how you look at it. Everybody's got to look at it. Say somebody got new shoes, something like that. Everybody be like, how he get them? How he get these? Instead of just saying, dang, they're nice, I want them. And they just get jealous and start hating. Somebody get a scholarship for D1, but someone think they better than them. They just going to hate. They not going to think they're not going to congratulate them or nothing. There's nothing really that, the manufacturers for the app could do. It's more of, a perspective on the app from the person itself.
Yeah. It all depends on the person and how they look at things. The only thing you could do is, I don't know, you got to, try to persuade, not even persuade them, but give them a positive outlet and, help them understand that everything is not about them, and what other people have will never reflect on who you are as a person or who you aren't as a person. Since they have stuff that you don't have, that don't mean they're better than you. Just go work for it.
Is that easier said than done?
Yeah, it is.
Is it easier said than done?
Yeah.
So, so a lot of times we discuss the issues, but let's try to look at what are some of the possible solutions to it, all right? So, again, because this is the opportunity for you all to voice your opinion, not just in this format, but speaking to a teacher or uncle or aunt, a coach, a cousin, an older cousin, seeking out individuals to discuss these issues with, social media. You said, how a person can look at what somebody else has, right, and wish they had that. And that can lead to depression. It can lead to anxiety. It can lead to negative feelings towards their parents. So, again, what specifically do you think that we should do to help? Because there are a lot of, do you all believe there are a lot of adults in the school and the community that do want to help?
Who is we? Are you saying we as in like adults?
Yeah, we as adults, as like as members of specifically this community, what can we do? You know, we want to hear from you all. Like, what can we do to specifically help you deal with our mental health issues or concerns that you have?
Our community really good. I like our community come together.
Give me an example of that.
Something for a kid. Say like when, say Jair, when he started getting all his offers, like nobody was hating on him for real. It was only people from like other places. Everybody in our community was happy for him, like because that was giving us looked at, and he was getting looked at the same time. So everybody in the community was happy for him and themselves because they all get to play with somebody that's about to go to the league.
One of the main things I like that our community does is the Juneteenth, like the parade before and then everybody at Pioneer Park and then everybody out there selling food, playing games, playing basketball together. Like that's really what we should be doing. We should do more stuff like that. Not even just wait till summer to do this or that, but like any positive outlet is the best way to go.
Yeah, our community come together real good. Like we're not no hating community. Like Kankakee is real good together. I feel like she said, with the Juneteenth, we need more of that. Like, we need more, like, stuff to do. Like, it's just one thing. So, like, other than that, we really don't got nothing else to do.
At the Hispanic Heritage Month and the activities they be doing, Juneteenth, those are two great examples. So, I like the fact that you all are saying that Kankakee does support a lot, right? There are a lot of adults who support teenagers. Do you all feel that way as well, that there are a lot of adults? So what can we do to, because again, social media is, it tends to show the negative that goes on. What can we do to highlight the adults that do support and how to, in the events that do happen that are positive, that has a positive impact on you all?
A lot of adults don't have like Instagram. So, like, Instagram is really, like, say if we get someone getting a fight today, everybody in the school probably going to see it. Mm-hmm. But, like, nobody going to see enough adult, like, an adult, like, caring for a kid or nothing like that. Or, like, backing a kid, nobody really see that because the adults don't got Instagram. All the kids do. So, everything, Instagram's really just kids now. Like, there's some adults with it, but not, like, as much kids. So, it's really nothing that they could do.
Yeah, just overpower the bad. Like, put yourself out there because the adults that do put themselves out there, it'd be just to say that they did it. It's not really out of, like, love for the kids or anything. But the adults that really do stuff, they don't get their recognition. Like, the newspaper, they don't put much that the community does out in the paper. But if we had 10 fights in one day at school, that'll be in the paper the next day. So we just got to try to find a way to, like, push everything out. The more events you do and the more kids that come to it, the more popular it'll get, and Kankakee be closer than ever.
Yeah. So, go ahead.
Our, like, Kankakee itself, it's like, we more known for, like, the bad stuff. We not known for nothing good. Like, we got good sports and stuff. We got good, like, mentors we could trust. Like, nobody knows that, though. Everybody think of Kankakee, like, a bad school, a bad place. Nobody want to live here because of what they put out on us. They don't put nothing good out on us.
So, it sounds like you are throwing a ball back into our court, that some adults, maybe we need to get our phones out, right, and show some of the things or talk about some of the things that we do that's positive in the community.
It's not even just y'all, though. Like, the newspaper, like she said, like, the only thing, like, the news, like, they posted us when the teacher last year said whatever he said. Like, they posted that. They didn't post nothing, like, when we went undefeated. They don't post nothing about that. Only in the newspaper. They don't. Nobody really show, like, love from out there. It's only people in Kankakee.
And I don't understand that because, like, just looking from the sports and academic perspective, Kankakee is thriving. Like, every single day it gets better and better. And then when the high school took off, that's what made, like, the community look at the younger schools like, okay, let's get them started early. I know a couple junior high, middle school kids that come and work out with high school every single day just to put the work in. By the time they get to high school, they'll be ready. And it's not even just sports. Academically, we have so many early college students. We have not only KCC, but the Olivet program as well. We have a lot of honor students, early graduates, but none of that is ever seen or spoke on.
Yeah, that's a good thing to speak on. Like, because like the kids that's younger, they got good parents. Like, their parents is mentoring them, right, because they was just recently in high school, like the younger ones. Mm-hmm. Like, back probably when our parents was kids, they probably didn't have no early college program, so they didn't expect us to be able to do that. But now, since they just graduated probably 5, 6, 7 years ago, it's probably like sixth grade down, that's when they started. Like, their parents probably seen this already. Our parents, they see it, so we didn't really get prepared for it. You had to be on your own to do that.
All right. Well, Devin, Sanaya, thank you for joining the podcast. We'd like to extend an invitation to anyone that's interested in being in the Kankakee High School Podcast Club. It's a safe space. It's a space where we not where we just won't discuss like serious issues, which we will put enough attention on, but fun items. We could discuss science. We could discuss entertainment. All right. So, a lot of issues, a lot of topics will be discussed in the podcast club. So we'd like to extend the invitation to you to join the podcast club, and we'd love to have you a part. And remember the power of mentorship. Remember the power of avoiding peer pressure. I'm Coach Jackson, I'm Mr. Jackson, and this is the Kankakee High School Podcast Club. Thank you for your time.